other places than here talking about our property tax assessments this morning. We'll start off, I guess, pledge of allegiance?
Yep.
Stand up, pledge of allegiance here.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
All right, so, why we're here? We all know the reason. We're all on the email chain. We're here because we saw our property assessments go up by double digits this past year. This is just a discussion this morning. There's not going to be any solutions here this morning. It's a discussion, educate ourselves about what's going on. And we have some elected officials that are going to answer some questions, give a presentation, and answer some questions. So, we have three county board members here. This is Joe.
Joe Gottemauer.
District three?
District three, but two of us are running. I'm the current county board, and your current county board chairman. This year, your county board chairman gets elected for the next election cycle by you guys countywide. So Michael and I are running against each other, and you'll get a chance to see that. But in the meantime, we'll be more than happy to answer questions and do our best to tell you what the process is.
Okay, next up, we got Andrew Gaser, District One Rep.
Yep.
Algonquin.
I'm down in Fox River Grove, and I am not up for election this time. I'm just here because I heard about this and I was asked to come speak. And look forward to telling you a little bit about the process of what you can do, how you can empower yourself to actually kind of take this on and actually start the process to change it.
Could you speak a little louder?
Absolutely. I promise I'll speak a lot louder next time. I apologize.
Okay, next up, we have Michael Walkup. He's District 3 Rep from Linda Township.
Hi, yeah, I'm Michael Walkup, so I represent District 3, which is a little bit south of here, includes some of Mchenry Township. I'm also, as Joe said, we had a referendum on the ballot 2 years ago that I helped put on the ballot that asked the voters whether or not they wanted to start electing the county board chairman at large. Up till now, we've elected it within the membership. And so it was a, you know, an inside kind of process. So voters said overwhelmingly they wanted to elect the county board chairman at large. So now I'm circulating petitions. Maybe they want to sign them on the way out to get on the ballot to run for county board chair at large. And I'm also running for my county board seat for re-election to that, so that way I can vote in both capacities and you get two elected officials for the price of one.
Okay, and then we were supposed to have Chuck Wheeler here. He's from our district. He's our District 4 rep. I guess he had an emergency this morning, so couldn't be here. We all know why we're here, so without further ado, we'll let Joe talk for a minute here.
Tax appeals and the process. What you should know first off is that this is the quadrennial assessment year. What does that mean? Every 4 years, the assessor's office is expected to look over their entire category of all the, in your case, when we're talking about assessor, we're talking about the township assessor. The township assessor's job is to look and say, what's the value of your house? And every 4 years, you're supposed to redo it. So you just got the quadrennial year. So what you're looking at when you decide, and this is the first part of the process. There's several steps before a tax bill comes out. First step is, what's the value of your house? Your assessed valuation under state statute, not something we set, is supposed to be one-third the value of your house. So that's not the only thing you look at, but when you're looking at your new assessed valuation, you have to look at, you know, what's my house actually worth? What I, and the fancy definition, right, it's not very fancy, is what would a ready, willing, and able seller sell to a ready, willing, and able buyer? So one of the questions you have to ask yourself when you decide about your appeal is my assessment near a price that I would sell my house at? Chances are for many of you it's not, because it's still lower than what you probably paid for your house. And that's because we've had a crisis in the last 7 years. I mean, anybody who, you know, if you bought your house prior to 2007, your house is worth less today than it was in 2007. There's just no doubt about that. So at any rate, though, I know that they've said, most of the people in Burton Township, all the people in Burton Township have gotten a postcard or have gotten a newspaper clipping that said, here's your new assessment. So now you say, well, gee, if mine's still lower than what I would sell it for, why shouldn't, you know, what good is an appeal do? Well, an appeal does one other thing, and that is it does compare what's going on around you. So if you're the highest guy in the neighborhood or gal in the neighborhood, you have to look and say, well, why is my house this much higher than anybody else's? And so there's actually two kinds of appeals. One is just flat out, you've got the price wrong. The second one is, I'm wrong in relationship to the people around me. The process of appeal is relatively simple. You can go online to the county assessor's office. The county doesn't set your original assessment. They can adjust it, and that's what and the county runs the board of review. I'm sure Michael and I, over the past, before I was on the county board, I did appeals. I don't do appeals anymore. I candidly don't want to go to jail. We appoint the board of review. It's not something that I should be appearing in front of. So I haven't done any appeals and don't expect to do any appeals in the near future, but you should know the process. You go online, you get the form. The form's not particularly complicated. You can also go online to compare all your property values. You can go to the assessor's website, go through McHenry County, go to the assessor's website. They will show you sales that happened in your area. They will also show you, literally line by line, if you look for it, every single house in your neighborhood, every single house in the entire county, every single piece of property in the entire county. So the information's readily available. If you think that you have an appeal based on the issue that your house has been just flat out overassessed, you know, they've assessed me $1 million and my house is worth $500,000, whatever. An appraisal is a great thing. If you've done a refinance in the last year, if you've done, you know, any type of work with your house in the last year, those appraisals are probably the best evidence that you'll get. If you can't, if that's not your issue, then you've got to do a wider gap, and you're probably going to need a real estate, either appraisal or somebody that can help you come on in. They can help you do that. You take that up to the board of review. You file that timely with the assessor's office. They'll set a board review hearing. That hearing is relatively short hearing. They're scheduled every 20 minutes, and that's because they're really just looking at your paperwork. They're not going to ask you to demonstrate. They're assuming that your paperwork already shows the best comparables that you could find. You're not probably going to walk in with a comparable. And I guess there's one other point you should know. The assessed valuation that you're seeing today is supposed to be what your house would have sold for on January 1 of this year. That's the date you look for. So the farther away your comparable is from that date, the less light, you know, that's the more it has to be adjusted to get back to what would it have sold for on January 1. Assuming you get the board review and you get a number that you like or don't like, you could go on beyond that to appeals, but that's a whole other chapter. That's one part of your tax bill. The second part of your tax bill is your rate. And I've heard a great deal of discussion recently about, well, how does the rates get set? The rates get set in two ways, and there's two parts to it. The first is every single government entity that's on your bill, and that'll be your town. If you're in a town, that'll be your township. That'll be your library district. That'll be your fire district. That'll be the county. It'll be all your schools, your grade school, your high school, the MCC, the college. All those things go together. They each have a line. They sit down as an entity and say, how much money do we need to run our operation? They ask for that amount of money. They don't necessarily get that amount of money because there's a property tax. The property tax cap comes into place. Sometimes there are some entities that have managed well and don't have a problem. There are some entities that haven't managed so well. When the property, and that gets you to the next thing. So the entities all say we need X dollars. They take the gross amount of tax available, or in terms of house value and property value in your area available, and they say, here's what we do next. We take that, we divide it into how much money we need. That gets us a rate. That rate goes to the county clerk. The county clerk has a computer program that the state of Illinois has mandated, and they plug it in, and if it's too high, if it's gone higher than the cost of living, they don't get that much money. If it's lower than that, obviously they get their whole amount. If you change the line, and this is something that the county has to deal with, if we decide we've got too much in one file, it doesn't let us actually just take and eliminate that file. It spreads that formula, or that computer program spreads whatever we take away from one category across all the categories. You then multiply those things to that rate and your tax assessment, and that's how your tax bill comes out in the end. You're really working at two separate things, though, when you're working on it. I mean, you have a chance to talk about your assessment. You don't have a whole lot of chance to do much about your rate, because your rate's at every level of government. And as I said, you can look at school districts, you can look at whichever group you want. At the county level in the last 3 years, we've actually kept the rate flat. What does that mean? We haven't, you've got a cost of living you're allowed to take under the property tax cap. We didn't take that money. What does it mean to you? Well, countywide, it's meant about $10 million in taxes we didn't collect at the county level. I'd be willing to bet you don't have that at any other level on your, when you look down the list. But that said, you're still stuck with, is your house assessed at a value that is either way different from my neighbor's or higher than my house is available to be sold for?
Yes.
And if that's the case, you should absolutely take an appeal and take it up. So with that, I'll let the others, and if you've got any questions, I'm here. I'll be glad to answer anything that you need.
Let's hold question. Hold your question, or do you guys want to do questions?
I don't. I don't want to. Whatever.
It's your meeting. Hold them till. Hold your question and let all three speak, and we'll go from there. Go ahead, Mike.
Yeah, like Mr. Gonimo, I'm a lawyer, but unlike him, I'm not a real estate lawyer, so I've never done the tax appeal process, so I'm not going to talk to you about that. You all are very lucky here. We're all very lucky in McHenry County. We're all 1%ers. Did you know that? We're in the top 1% of all the counties in the nation for our real estate taxes. We're number 27 or 29, depending on what you look at, out of about 3,000 and some odd counties in the nation. So that's not a 1% you necessarily want to be in. What Mr. Gottemore said is what you do within the existing system to appeal your taxes. The problem is, and I think this whole thing underscores, the problem is actually with the way the system is set up. Back in the 1850s, when the county was very rural, and my family actually were here then, everybody was kind of evenly spread out throughout the county. Most people lived in farms. I still live on the same farm that my great-great-grandfather built. He had right at that time. And they set up a system of townships. And so we're going to divide everything up in these neat little geographical areas. And we're going to create separate little sort of mini-governments in each of these areas to do certain limited functions. And we have 17 of them in McHenry County. And for some oddball reason, Richmond and Burton were created as separate townships, even though McHenry and Nunday and Algonquin are all the same size and the same tier, are one township. I don't know why they did that. Somebody told me once it was because they thought they had to accommodate for the curvature of the earth as you went north. I don't know. But if you look at the map, it's ridiculous. One of the functions that the townships do are that they're responsible for the assessments. And back in the 1850s, what the township assessor did is he got, he hooked old Bessie up to the buckboard, or the buggy, and got his little notepad and his quill pen and his little bottle of ink, and went out and rode around to the different homes and farms and assessed them. And so he needed to be able to get out and back, in the course of the day, and get Bessie back to the barn and feed her oats and be with his family. He didn't want to have to be stuck halfway across the county. So the township assessments were set up to be done in these little geographical areas because of the distance that a horse could travel and get back in one day. So now we have a system where we got 17 different assessors. There's no standards really, on how they're going to be doing the assessments. And they each have their own little foibles on how they can do their assessments. Some of them are very full-time in the townships now, because in the modern age, we have, contrary to having everybody spread out equally over the county, we have people concentrated in certain areas and then lighter populations in other areas. And so the areas where we have a lot of people, we have a full-time assessor who's got a staff, who's professional, who's trained, and they can go out and they can do the assessments. In other townships, which are smaller, you have an assessor who might be part-time, might have a day job, might be running a farm. And then they go out and they do the assessments in the same way. So it's a goofy system. So we tried this year to make some inroads and make some changes in that system. And we had a big effort to try to consolidate some of the townships, chief among them of which was Richmond and Burton. And a task force was set up by Mr. Gottemuller, and basically what happens, all the township officials showed up and turned the task force into kind of a circus. And they came out with basically no recommendations other than maybe to consolidate Burton and Township, Burton and Richmond and a couple other townships, came to the county board. We have the authority to put the thing on the ballot, okay? On the ballot means that you would have decided all the issues, and if any township didn't want to consolidate with any other township, they just voted no. And so if Burton Township didn't want to consolidate with Richmond Township, they had veto power. They just said, no, we don't want to do it, that ends it, it's done. So only if the majority of each township wanted to consolidate would a consolidation have happened. Our view, our role as I saw it, was simply to simply a ministerial one of putting it on the ballot. Instead, what happened is it became a great big huge thing about the merits of the consolidation. And Mr. Gottemuller, I have to say, led the charge in stopping it. Gave a big speech at the meeting where we were going to vote. And we wound up being a 13-9 vote. He voted against consolidation, even though he's an attorney for one of the townships that would have been consolidated. We had another county board member.
All right. Wait a minute. If we're going to have campaign speeches about that, I just want a chance to respond. Okay. Mr. Walker actually represented for a long period of time one of the petitioners. So, you know, let's be straight.
That's not why we're here.
Yeah, that's not why we're here.
I was just going to throw.
I appreciate that. Yeah. That's not why.
I was going to throw a time off, like, if we're not. Yeah. We're talking.
What I want to address is that I think the reason you're having a problem with your assessments is because we have this crazy quilt system of assessments. Okay? And I think we need to make some fundamental changes in the way in which the whole process is different. One of the ways would be to consolidate townships. One of the ways which we're going to be discussing in our 2016 plan for the county is to look into maybe having a county assessor. But you have to have legislative enactments to do that. You could have a county, Cook County has a county assessor who's elected. Townships don't do assessments in Cook County. You can have the county assessor be appointed. We have a county assessor, but his job is not to do the assessments. His job is to review the assessments for the purpose of, you know, rationalizing some of the assessments. We could go to that kind of system. We could introduce computer systems, which they've done recently in Lake County, to try to equalize the assessments between some of the way that the individual assessors do all the assessments. But that's really the fundamental problem here, I think, is that we have a system of assessments that's derived from the 19th century horse and buggy society. Okay, and it doesn't work anymore. And when we try to change things, the people who have a vested interest in the existing system come out in force and scare people off, and we don't do the changes. So we're going to have an opportunity now to make some further study of the townships, because we do have this power as a county board to consolidate the townships, to put it on the ballot for the voters to consolidate the townships. And so I'm hoping that we're going to be looking into that a little further, looking at the inequalities in the different townships, which extends to things like rural districts. One of the reasons your taxes are higher in these more populated counties is that the road commissioners have jacked up their budgets and jacked up their salaries, even though they have the same amount of road miles that the people in the rural townships have. Your supervisors have jacked up their salaries, even though they have the same amount of work to do, basically, as the supervisors in the rural townships, and have staff oftentimes to help them. It's just a very unequal system. It's something that nobody's looking at because they're hidden. They have no rules about nepotism. they hire their own spouses in some cases. So I think the real problem here is not, let's say, what's working the existing system. We have to right now. You have to do your appeals and go through the legal process. But I think we need to look at some fundamental structural change and try to equalize the process and make it fair for everybody around the county.
Sorry, Mike. Sorry, Joe, but I'm not a lawyer. My name is Andrew Gosser. I grew up in McHenry County, Fox River Grove. I have a lot of friends here in Spring Grove. And what I can tell you is that Fox River Grove is a lot like Spring Grove. You know, it's a great place to live. Our quality of life that we have here in McHenry County, it's second to none. We are truly at the top when it comes to quality of life. But let's face it, the real threat that we have to our quality of life is our property taxes. It's absolutely ridiculous. I know that we are the 29th highest property taxed county in the United States of America. It's not even debatable. And the problem is that the people that we put into power, it doesn't matter whether it's a township or a county board, we all bear that responsibility from our state reps all the way down to our school boards. We are all responsible for our property taxes. And unless we start getting involved, like we're all doing this morning, and start talking about that, we are going to continue to have that problem. For me personally, I know people here in Spring Grove who have lived here, including the Burton 3 Precinct Committeeman, Lori White. Maybe somebody knows her. You know, she moved 4.5 miles that way. She moved to Wisconsin. We are being crushed by our property taxes, and I appreciate the appeals process and the rates, and I appreciate all the work that the people have done, but it's simply not good enough. We simply have to start telling our elected officials, look, you're either going to lower your rate or we're booting you out. It's just that simple. I gotta tell you, McHenry County Board is board, and I'm just there, I'm only there for 10 months now, 11 months. But they have held the line by keeping the rent flat rate. And we're actually having a big fight right now, as Mr. Gautamala brought up, about are we going to abate a tax to you where it says we're going to take it, but then we're going to refund it. So we're still keeping our levy the same. So because a computer program can't figure out how to do it, are we actually going to cut your taxes? I can tell you I am for cutting it, and I will fight like hell to cut your taxes, but I may lose. But even if I win, you are all still going to feel it, because it's going to start with your police or your fire district and your township and your village. They will still all tax you. So all the hard work we are about to do will still get smashed unless people like you become active inside the political arena and basically tell your school boards and your village boards and your fire protection districts, your conservation district, your 708 board, you have to tell them, look, we can't afford this anymore, because I know what's happening. I'm not up for re-election. I'm working down in County Board District 1, so that's Algonquin, Caring, Fox River. I've already knocked on over 1,500 doors, and I've talked to well over 1,000 people. And almost every single one of them says if they could leave Illinois, they would. And why is that? It's our property taxes. And everybody sits here working, well, we can go after the assessment, we can try to change the... We don't care about that. We want results, right? We want to say, how do we lower our property taxes? And the only way I know is to be able to control it locally. One of my favorite sayings is, control what you can control. If we're talking about elections, how can you change a president? We have one vote for president. But you know, that's 51 million votes to elect a president. But how many votes does it take to elect a new village trustee? About 350. Right? So that needs a new mayor too. 350 votes. How about a new county board member? You know, that's about 4,000 votes, but if you want to try to change your congressman, that's about 430,000. How much to change a school board member? About 330 here in Spring Grove. How much is it to change a state rep? Good luck beating Jack Franks. And I said that on tape, by the way. So everybody's going, oh my God. So my point is I want you
to start learning about this process, but I want you to take an active control of the things that you can control and not worry about the things that you can't. And I am here simply to say there are people out there who are trying to actively lower your property taxes, and we definitely need to use the system, but we also basically need to say, look, the system stinks and we need to change it. And if you're not going to change it, if you're not going to fight for it, then please get out of the way and elect somebody who can. Because this isn't about sitting here having a popularity contest or taking a pension, which I'm not. We get good pensions. I'm not taking the health care, even though it's really good health care than what better we might have. And we need to make sure that we're term limiting ourselves. Get in there, fix what you can fix, and move on. And that's why I'm here. I'll be happy to answer any of your questions, and thank you very much. Appreciate it.
All right, so those are all very good political stump speeches, I think. Just my opinion. This is why we're here, right, folks? Yes. 29 points. That's what I just heard. How many heard any one of these guys talk about what we're here for? Raise your hand. I mean, Andrew did touch on it. I give him that. I don't know if I heard too much from Joe, and I think Michael went down the track a little bit too, but this is why we're here. 29.59% year-over-year increase. That's why we're here. That's what we want an answer to. There's no justice in that. I think I just asked the question that everybody is here to ask you guys.
You're right.
And not, I don't think anybody here answered that. We heard political stump speeches. No more political stump speeches, guys. The buck stops right here. So, Joe, you want to comment again?
Sure. It's a quadrennial assessment, folks. That's what they do. They're asking you, and that's what I started. The way to change it is to appeal. If you don't appeal the taxes, it's going to stay right where it's at. In terms of Michael would like to change the whole thing, I don't want to go down that. I'll be glad to talk about township consolidation if you want to, but that's not what you're here for. I try to give you the from my perspective, what I not from my perspective. It's the only way you can change that.
So Joe, did the whole county go up? 27%?
The whole county went up. It depends on where you live and what your assessments. None of the townships hasn't published yet. I don't know what mine's done.
So Joe,
I'm sure it's going up.
My sister lives maybe half a mile from my neighborhood. You know when taxes went up? 1.29%.
Well, so then she's probably looking at a different assessor.
Same Burton Township.
Okay.
Same
then
assessor.
You have to look and see why your Burton Township assessor hit this group different than that group.
Okay, I can answer that question. So when many of us call, I called as soon as I opened the thing and said, there's got to be an obvious error for it to year over year equalize the assessed value going up by 29.58%. There's a problem there. She said, no, there's no problem. I reassessed your area, and I was directed to do this because of the mistakes made by the previous assessor and mistakes made by the previous board of review members. And that was the explanation I was given. And she told me, go fight it at the, just as you're telling, go appeal it.
But
she said,
I'm going to do
her exact words were, they're not going to do anything for you.
I don't know that they're not going to do anything for you.
And I understand that context. I understand.
I don't know what you were assessed before. I mean, I didn't look at your tax bill.
But this whole group was mistakes were made. This whole group.
I don't doubt it, but that's how you fix the mistakes is you do the appeal.
Chris,
if you don't do the appeal, they won't fix the mistake if you don't do the appeal.
My wife and I, we built our house in 2006 at the height of the real estate market. It was assessed, right?
Okay.
Now you're telling me now, like our taxes go up maybe $500, $800. We can deal with that, mm-hmm. right? Now I get a bill in the mail. And my potential net is going to be $4,000 higher, 31.67 increase.
Which
we've been assessed. We were not assessed properly in 2006. Come on.
Well, I don't know what you're assessed in 2006. Again, I'm not in a situation where I can say what was your bill, what was it before. All I can tell you is the question you're supposed to ask is when they give you the new assessment, they're supposed to be saying, is this what a ready, willing, and able buyer would be willing to pay for this house if you were already willing and able to sell.
And you want us to write the check and just not say anything?
I don't want you to write the check. I want you to take an opinion.
You know, what we're here is to find out from you guys. You guys are up for reelection. What are you guys going to do to solve this issue? This is an issue.
You've got the wrong people in the office. You want to change that issue, you call the state reps.
Yeah, oh, Barbara Wheeler is probably watching right now at home. She is well aware.
But we're not, there's nothing that the county board can do that will change that physical, that process. That's a state legislative process. I mean, I'm here to try to tell you how to go about protecting your rights the best you can, but I don't have the ability. There's not a single piece of legislation I can put in at the county board that's going to change the property tax appeal process.
So it's completely, it's legit in Illinois to just, as Chris and everybody here.
Saying it's legit. I'm saying appeal your taxes.
I think we've got two issues here.
One is
what's happening right this minute.
Sure.
And the other is the bigger political arena. I don't think that this room of 60 people are going to affect the political arena right now today. What I'm here for is to understand the real process, not just the paperwork, not what website to go into. How do we find a comp? How do we find a comp that hasn't been short or foreclosed? My insurance, my real estate, includes those in my comp. The taxes don't. How do we understand that process?
And that's why you go on that and look at all of the sales in your area, and then you try to find sales that are like your house. I mean, and realtors can help you, appraisers can help you.
Excuse me. This is kind of like a dog and pony show so far. You know, what you're not telling these people is the tools. You're not giving them the tools how to appeal. I've settled a dozen rentals in Lake County, so I do this yearly.
Come on up and
well, you guys, all three of you guys, you're campaigning right now. You guys need to teach these people how to appeal. You briefly touched the PTAB, the state, and you said that's another chapter. No, that's not another chapter. Because what you guys are doing, and Jessica Huber, I'm really disappointed that she's not here, because all she does is kick the can down
she's
to the board.
Right now, so.
And then Cliff Holton gets this complete us down in Mchenry every winter, you know, on our PTABs, or on our appeals. Educate these people. You say go to the MLS. Realtors are already taking a hit. They're not going to spend the time to pull comps. And MLS is great. What happens when you're fighting the assessment, not the comparable sales, the assessment?
Yes.
And you go to this website that you guys supposedly have now, which is terrible in my opinion. It doesn't tell you if it's a two-story, one-story. It doesn't tell you if it has brick, siding, finished basements. How many bathroom fixtures? And you need that information. Tell these people you need that information, especially when you go to the state. Where am I going to get that from? I called Jessica Huber. You know what she says? I'll give you five or six. No, you're a public official. I want all of them. I want hundreds of them. You got to give me the property record card. She's tipping up to a line of state's attorney when she's only going to say, I'm going to give you five or six record property records.
She has to give you the records.
Well, then you know what? She's going to be busy because I need all of them. And I need those. But you guys, I mean, thank you for being here, but you aren't even in Burton Township. We need somebody with substance that's in Burton Township. Jessica Huber and Bob, the chief assessor, where is he?
Yeah, but he should be something here. That board members can do here.
Yes.
And then you can have some influence on the supervising assessor in the county. We feel targeted. We're sitting here, got off in the rain, come on here, because we feel targeted in certain areas in Burton Township. It's not all of Burton Township that got smoked. I saw one that their property tax went down $8,000. 70%. I read the spreadsheet.
Their assessment went down.
Tax dollars. I read the spreadsheet.
We extrapolated on the spreadsheet.
Okay.
2013, and we took last year's tax.
I'm concerned about the arbitrariness of the process. I'm concerned about how certain subdivisions can be targeted, and this time around, you guys are going to get smoked. Us are going to get smoked.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm not even anywhere near the worst of the bunch, but it's infuriating how this is so arbitrary. It's not township-wide. Oh, this subdivision is due for us just an absolute smoke. It's ridiculous, but you can do something. I do thank you, by the way, for coming here, because it's not easy to do, I'm sure. There's some things you'd rather do. But can you pressure the supervising assessor to stop this targeting BS in double-digit increases? That's ridiculous. Where is that done anywhere else?
how about you guys make the call to Jessica tonight or Monday?
Yeah.
And another thing.
Can you guys communicate with supervisors? You have administrative responsibilities.
Bob Ross is the next guy to talk to.
And let me make
I spoke to Wednesday. Bob Ross yesterday, basically because I knew I was coming here. He has said point blank, if you call him at his office, he will talk to you, he will arrange time to meet with you or talk to you.
But that cannot change the past.
It can't change what was just published. The only way you're going to change what was just published is to appeal that.
And folks, I got two things at the end here, two things already that I'll comment on. Wednesday, we're having another meeting with Bob Ross. Jessica Huber's going to be there, and I think Michael Eisenberg.
That's the one to attend.
That Wednesday.
Wednesday.
Where?
It's going to be at the Village Hall. It's on
Spring Grove.
I've been, Spring Grove. Yep, Village. The Village Hall in Spring Grove. You guys are all on email. I'll keep you guys. Obviously, I've been blasting you in the morning and blasting you in the evening with an email, and I'll keep doing that. And you guys will know that the meeting is Wednesday, November 4th, and it's at 7 p.m. I believe. Don't quote me on that.
What's the deadline to appeal?
Deadline to appeal is November 15th. And I've got something to comment on that too, so the comments that I'll make here when we're done.
Those that want to do comps, there's a really good website called Redfin, R-E-D-F-I-N. Log in, create an account, it's free, and then you can get all of their homes that sold in the last couple years that are comparable. You put your home in there, and it'll automatically search and find homes that sold in the last 2 years. You can build your comps in 10 minutes.
Go ahead.
We're kind of aliens here because we're from McHenry Township.
Yes.
It was our daughter lives in Spring Grove, and she kind of forwarded the information about this to us. And we've been getting really 32.27%.
Yeah, I'd be interested. I lobbied for the databases from the other townships. They're kind of reluctant to give them to me, but I have lobbied for your township because I want to do the same spreadsheet analysis that I did and see where this targeting is happening. But I did put in, and you have my email.
I think have yours, but I couldn't put my email on your site this morning. I tried.
Okay, you have my email though.
I don't. I only have your website.
Okay, on the website, my email is listed about three sentences down on the website. And I just visit afterwards, I can give it to you. What I would ask you to do is lobby your assessor to give you the database for McHenry Township. And then you can forward me the database, and I will do exactly what I did with our database, manipulate your data. That's what I want to do. I'd love to have every township
data. Well, that's what I was thinking, if we joined together as a whole county.
Ask them nicely one time, and if they don't do it, FOIA it.
Yeah, I did a FOIA. I did a FOIA request.
Don't honestly, I know it came off like I was kind of political, but you're in a political situation, and I know politics sucks. But quite honestly, if you don't go up and punch these people in the face, politically, not physically, and you don't start throwing FOIA bombs around, and you don't start pushing,
FOIA
is a freedom of information. Because they're not. And it gets back to my whole point. They'll sit there and they'll just kick the can around and we'll just push the numbers around. And nothing's going to change. If you want to change it, yes, you have to go through the appeals and get your rates done. But if you do not do more than just that, then you're wasting your time. And I know people don't want to hear that, but I'm not going to tell you what you want to hear. I'm going to tell you the truth. So that's how you're going to have to do it.
It is a waste of time. The appeals process is archaic. We have a one story. I defy anybody to find another house like ours. I have every house that was sold in Burton Township from January 1st through July 31st, right here. Anybody want to look at it? You can. It's disgusting. There is no way that you can accurately appeal your taxes. It's an archaic system, and you can't find comparables. If you're going to make me have that, then please make it available.
You made a statement that the assessor was directed to come back to our subdivision.
No, not come back to the entire township. It's not necessarily your subdivision. The entire
and
township.
Who made that directive?
Every 4 years.
Who made the directive?
The directive is done by the state statute that says every four
no.
years you
who told the assessor to do this?
every 4 years, the assessor by state statute is required to do a quadrennial assessment.
That's not what you said. You said that she was told because there was mistakes and things.
He said that was totally, I didn't have that.
She said, who said that to the assessor?
So if you look at past meeting notes on the board in both July and April of last year, Jessica brought that forward. Bob said to move ahead with it, even though there was double-digit increases.
Bob who?
Bob Ross.
Bob Ross, chief assessor for McHenry County.
The one who's not here.
He's the one that we're going to be speaking with on Wednesday.
See, the whole thing is where it starts, not where it ended. We need to know who is the person that directed her to come back.
Those are all in the historical meeting notes on the website.
It's a township website.
Yep.
Township website.
Fairtownship.com.
I have one other question. Who's paying for the lawsuit about you guys' pensions? And you, the county?
I'm not aware of a lawsuit.
Yeah.
Yes, there's a lawsuit, a class action lawsuit brought against the county board for their MIRF.
IMRF.
Because they're supposed to.
I haven't been served with it. I can serve with all of them. I haven't been served with that.
Yeah. So where you're supposed to, you can either go 1,000 hours or 600 hours?
Well, I know the local 150 is doing things that they like to talk about then. If they're filing a suit, they haven't serviced with it yet. I don't have any sense to work.
So I just want to, I mean, I know people don't want to hear the long term, but this is really, the whole reason you're having a problem here is because of the bifurcated system that you have for assessments. Okay. The county, you're talking to the wrong people about assessments because the way the system is set up, it's done by the townships. And if you want to make the township assessors accountable, and they have to do it at the elections. The problem is that nobody shows up for the township elections because they don't know when they are.
But the county supervising assessor, Mr. Ross,
right,
directed our township assessor to do these things. So she's beholden to him. And I believe he's beholden to you.
No. No, he's beholden to Illinois state statute for such. Mm-hmm.
You have no administrative authority, no policy-making authority over him?
Policy-making, none whatsoever. Isn't he appointed? He is appointed by us, and so in theory we...
Get rid of him.
He's appointed by you.
Get rid of him.
Whoever's in that role is going to be stuck with the same statute.
So why did he start with our neighborhood specifically?
I don't have any idea why he's there.
We'll find out Tuesday.
I was going to tell you, the township election will be in 2017 in the spring when you have your municipal election. So, and you need to, if you don't like the assessor, you've got to find somebody who's got the credentials to be the assessor to run against them because typically nobody runs. And you have to have certain credentials in order to run, and you have to go out and circulate a petition. So that's how you make the township assessor accountable, is you hold his feet to the fire every 4 years when they have the elections, which are an odd number of years, every 4 years. So the next opportunity is going to be 2017. After that, you won't have another opportunity for 4 more years. So you have to be on your toes. We have to start organizing, and the way you hold people accountable is through the election process. If people don't show up for the election, if people are in the dark about when the elections are, if they're confused because the election for the township is a different cycle than all the other elections, which take place every 2 years, the townships every 4 years, and people forget, oh, is this year we have the township or not? That's the problem.
I thought I just understood, though, that it doesn't matter because the assessor is beholden to the statutes.
Well, so but you can change the assessor.
We were just told
he has
that the assessor does according to the state statute.
Yeah, but he has discretion on how he sets the assessments. He has to assess them every 4 years, but he doesn't have to. How he does it, it's a judgment call. Okay. So if you don't like the judgment calls that the assessor is making, place the assessor.
Well, I called Jessica months ago, and she was the one that told me that three neighborhoods in Spring Grove was her target. So. Because ours went up, we bought our house in 2009, and ours went up, actually did the math, 50% after we bought. So I've tried to fight every year, and I've gotten nowhere. Called your schools, Eugene, and so that's us. So, did anyone else go up like other years prior to?
No.
When we bought it, it was 8, we got our bill.
12. I mean, 12. But our assessed value is 200,000 less than, I mean, so what do I even do? I would go up. Our house is not, is definitely worth more than what it says. Mm-hmm. But our taxes are 12.5. I mean, why?
I think this is the first year for us here where we had high double digit, 15, 20. I think all of us can say in the last 5-6 years, it's fluctuated plus or minus 4, plus or minus 5%. Our argument here today is all of us here went up. Why, you know, I mean, mine's 29.58. Come on, let's hear some numbers.
31.8.
That's what's wrong. There's something wrong with this.
Ross.
So did we get comparable? What did we start doing before? Before? I mean, what do we got?
Talking about comparable, I would look at that.
We have 15 days, so we got to be able to get comparable.
The other part of your deal process is to look at, you know, why is your neighborhood singled out, and that's correct. You know, why is your, I don't know how, you know, I don't know much about your particular neighborhood other than what it seems to me is that everybody's gone up 30%. So why is, and I agree with you, why is your neighborhood different from the one across the street?
It was very, I assumed everybody was high when ours went up, and then I, in the last year, was looking into it more, and it was all over the board. I thought we should have gone down to match everybody. Houses that were similar to ours were 8, and it just, there was no rhyme or reason, which she could say, she was, but I assumed she was going to bring
the high ones
down,
not
everybody up. So
you're saying through the appeal process, but you're saying you've done it and it was unsuccessful. So is the appeal process, are we all going to go through the appeal process and it's going to be a waste of time?
Yeah.
All right, so that leads me to what I was going to say. All right, so at the end of the day, the comparable thing, it's a BS game in my opinion, but it's a game you play. We can't win. You go in there against 4 other guys behind a computer, you're a little Joe Blow homeowner, and they look at you like, oh well, too bad, have a nice day. They may sprinkle a little deduction on you, just make them think you feel you got something, but it to us is just common homeowners, it's a game. So my opinion would be, we are going to compare as a group. Instead of comparing and pitting each other to do all this monkey work of this house, that house, this house. No, we're a group. We'll compare our group to, let's compare to a subdivision over here that only went up 2% or went down minus 2%.
Yeah, absolutely.
The comparison is, why did we go up 30%? You know, we could do the average here and say, why did we go up in that 25%? Why is this town or subdivision?
Exactly.
Yeah, instead of playing this game where we're going to pit each other, Joe Kime against Joey St. Pierre against the Malik's. No, the game's, no, we're not going to play that game. We'll get a lawyer if we have to. We'll take it as a group comparable. Let's do a group comparison. Because I think, in my opinion, that's what we're arguing. None of us had any issues. The plus or minus 5-6% year to year. I get that. I understand that. It's when you see something that's 20-25%, even above 10 is ridiculous. That's what we're arguing.
I highly encourage every single one of you to appeal with the board in the county. You have to do that. If you don't do that, you cannot go to the state. Once you appeal, whether
exactly.
You win or lose, doesn't matter. They'll give you the piece of paper with the change or no change. You have 30 days to appeal with the state. The state will take up to 2 years. Generally, the county will intervene and negotiate with you. I've always gotten a negotiation with the state. When the state's involved, not with the state, I take that back. When the state's involved, the chief assessor will call me and say, will you accept this? It's worth it, guys. It's more paperwork, but you gotta do it. You have to appeal with the county, though. You got 15 days, do it. This election, we don't have time for another election. We gotta pay taxes now.
Yeah.
We don't have time for 2017, all that BS. You gotta appeal. And you gotta get on that phone with Jessica Huber and get your proper information, because you're gonna see on the appeal form, it's gonna ask you, finished basement, how many bathroom fixtures, things of that nature, brick, siding, you need at least 3 comparables. Give them 6 to 9.
How do you get them up?
Redfin, that's fine, but Redfin is an avenue, but if you're going to do assess, value on the tax assessment, Redfin won't hurt, well, won't help you.
No.
So you still, and Redfin, if you didn't sell your house, you won't be on Redfin.
And you won't, yeah.
If I'm gonna fight on the assessed value, you have two options, assessed value or comparable sales.
Yeah.
I encourage you to do it, that's my argument with these guys, we need the proper tools to appeal. And it's not, Lake County has a great site, everything's out there, turns out the grid for you. It's an awesome site, tells you everything. You type in a PIN number, you can look it up, is it the same house code, it tells you.
And you know, I'll put a link, the Burton Township, and, I didn't see this originally, but they do have now a GIS link that takes you to a map. And it is, it's not the most user-friendly interface. But you can, you know, it's not like Zillow, where Zillow pretty much leads you, you know, whatever you want. It's a not a user-friendly interface, but you can get, you know, you can put in a search for last year, all sales, between this dollar amount, this dollar. There's a bunch of different variables that you can put in. It takes a minute, it searches, because it's searching a government database. Searches, 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 then it comes back, and but it does work, and it does give you the information that. And you can even search PIN numbers and everything through that.
Yeah, appeal, don't lay down.
Yeah, and I,
does it have to be a current year appeal on a sold house?
You mean comparable?
Yes.
I'm going back.
No, you can, I think they're kind of lean, you know, if you bring in, I don't, here's my advice.
Okay.
Play the game however you want, whatever you want to do. I don't know what advice, because I don't know how to, it's trying to beat the system.
I don't know how to appeal if there aren't houses that I can.
It depends on who's on the table at the board.
Yeah.
You'll get one, two people say within a mile.
You can go back, you do the best that you have. I mean, if there's no comparables that you can find, then there's no comparables the other side finds. They keep expanding that circle to find one. And they go before January 1st, if they don't have any after January 1st. They will look both directions. I mean, just as any appraiser would do, you've gotta look to find what's the closest thing on the market that you can compare to.
Exactly, but does it have to be in Burton Township?
Yes.
Can it cannot be in Richmond, okay. That's what we have to grant it.
We're currently on the market, we have an active appraisal. They couldn't find any in Burton Township. We're compared to starting up toward Wisconsin, out toward Antioch and Libertyville. They couldn't find. We're held to a standard to play this game that the realtors can't, it's a game, and it's just, how do you play the game? I've heard that term about six times, that's maddening.
You bring in the best comparables you can find.
But if there aren't any.
If there aren't any, you keep going further back in time.
You gotta go back.
Going forward in time, you keep looking for something.
The other question is, does it include short and foreclosed? I was told that for this purposes.
They will argue with you that it does not include short sales. I would still, if that's all I had, I'd still bring them in.
That's our real estate is all.
The state says you have to. Our links transaction, the state. The assessor will tell you that, hey, we don't really accept distressed property. But what she or he won't tell you is the board will consider it, if that's all you have, and definitely the state will.
The real estate company considers it when they set our value.
The bank is selling it at an arm's length agreement to run as well.
And it's virtually, especially in 08, 09, 010, and 010, everything is short.
Right, it's a good thing that we get a tax, a flat tax, I haven't raised it in 2-3 years. That's great, but also tell these people that, hey, we got a lot of foreclosures, that people weren't living in those houses, and the banks are still paying the full tax. No one's using the stills, no amenities, that's free money.
I brought that up.
Well, where's that going?
We brought that up.
And what I talk about that issue with schools, Crystal Lakes, where I live, they're down 2 entire grade levels in terms of population. They've closed up.
But the houses are still getting paid, unless I go down there and I buy tax lien, but still, the banks are paying the taxes, 10 grand, and there's no amenities being used by that household. That's free money.
All right, one of the problems, and I filed, you know, an appeal, but the property used, I don't know what the tax quadriannual is, because it doesn't, it is not available. You know what I'm saying?
No,
so if I look at a comp, all right, I'm basing it on my existing, you know, tax base. But now if I go from, let's say, my taxes are going to go up from 10 to 15,000 because of the quadriennial. And if you look at your comps, you can't look at that.
You're jumping to the back end with the tax bills. When you're doing appeal, you're just appealing, what's the value of my house? You're not appealing the value of your tax bill.
Or cash value.
Okay, you're looking at your fair cash market value of your house. So you're not worried about, I know you're personally very worried about your tax bill, but you're worried about what the part that we're gonna multiply that rate by, and that's the part that you can appeal. So you're just looking at the value of houses right now.
Question, so this Bob Ross, he's appointed by you guys?
He's appointed by us, but he's got some statute things that he can go in and actually, if this whole neighborhood's off, and you can see that it's off, he has some adjustment abilities that he can do at that level. But he can't, he doesn't actually assess your individual tax rates. That's what comes to the township.
So Joe, could Bob Ross have, like, instead of 30, 31, 36%, could he have done 50, 100%?
Yeah, there were people in that spreadsheet, there are folks that are assessed over 100%.
And if so, who oversees Bob Ross?
That's what the board review does.
There's gotta be some.
Are you guys on the board right now?
No.
We appoint the board.
Some states do. Illinois does not. Some states have a max cap that they can raise your assessment year over year. Illinois does have something buried in the statutes, but I don't know the legal jargon, that the max that they can raise you is 5% unless they follow certain steps. Now, I did not investigate.
That's the property tax levy. That's not the same thing.
Okay, so that's not the same thing. Okay.
You appoint Bob Ross, and then you appoint the people that oversee Bob Ross.
Well, the reason it doesn't is that we're not allowed to go in. I'm not allowed to go in as a county board member and say, you know, I'm firing the board of review. I mean, all that's going to do is have the state come in and take it over. I mean, the board review is generally consistent.
So we could make a
mistake
more quickly if we did that.
Well, I know. You probably have a defect in your appeal. I mean, they'd probably not let you.
Oh, for what we're talking about, Barbara Wheeler is our representative, the 64th district. She is the one that would represent us to eventually get a cap on what they can raise our year-over-year property assessments by.
Well, I know she can't be here, but for whatever reason, but is she in your conversation? Is she friendly to us?
Yeah, she's on our side. I spoke with Barbara yesterday. She is, like I said in the email this morning, she's investigating this on her end. Right. Because she doesn't agree with this. She doesn't agree that, you know, you can just go in and lobby a 25% year-over-year increase in an assessment. She is in agreement with that. But I think, as we're seeing here this morning, what do you do about that?
Right.
Who's the man in charge? Who do we talk to? Who do we tar and feather? That's what we're looking for this morning, and nobody wants to, Bob Ross, I guess, is about the one that we should start pointing fingers at. Now, these guys are here because we're voicing our concern, our elected officials. They need to know what we're talking about.
Can we get the board of review that reviews Bob? Can they be there for this meeting?
How do they determine the board of review?
The board of review is a group of people that apply for the job. Mm-hmm. They have state requirements that they have appraisal certificates, and they have, they're basically appraisers.
Mm-hmm. And they have standard terms, so we can't just get rid of all of them.
Cliff Holton is still on the board?
I don't know. I don't remember.
He lives in Forest Ridge. I'm sure he can make a call.
Yeah, he could be there one day. Another thing I want to bring up, our assessors, do you guys know by law, do they need to live in a county, township, county, or
township? If elected, yes.
If appointed, no. Okay.
You're correct.
So, but you can't stand for re-election.
Mm-hmm. So, Joe, one more question. Does it behoove us to think about litigation in any of this?
Well, your litigation is exactly what the gentleman said. You start with board review. That's the beginning of your litigation. You can then take it to the Property Tax Appeal Board in Springfield. And the appeal process. That's the process that you
so
take.
So we can't hire an attorney?
You can hire an attorney.
We will. That is
a new one.
Yeah, we will. We'll hire that.
There's two or three in McHenry County that do a lot of this.
Is it a subdivision, say, or is it a group?
That would be your deal, you negotiate with whoever you decide to hire. But there are, without a great deal of effort, I'm sure you can find some that do this.
But a group could stand before supervising assessor or other people in the process as a group?
There's no reason why you couldn't, assuming that...
Yeah, there's no reason why we couldn't say that.
It still sounds like it still has to start with this.
You have to start with it.
We all have to do it individually.
Yeah, it's individual.
Every one of us should.
Yeah, we'll all file an individual appeal, but then as a group, we'll find a lawyer or even a representative, even if it happens to be myself, but probably more appropriate than a lawyer, and have a lawyer, see if we can get a lawyer that says, I'm gonna go fight you guys as a group appeal. And I mean, it may be totally unconventional, but we got nothing to lose.
It'll keep you in the forefront.
Yeah, yeah.
I mean, I think you have to pay lawyers, but...
That's the road I was going to. Once you bring the lawyers in, now we're just feeding the system more.
You guys can do this yourself, I'm telling you. You know, lawyers can take 40%.
Yeah.
You can do it yourself.
That's where I'm going with it.
Know your community, do it yourself. It'll take you the first time, maybe an hour, to file the appeal.
No, I think, how many of us in here have fought our appeals before?
Well, by the time we get all the appeals.
Yeah, a bunch of us have.
Why don't we get together and do our appeals together so that we know that we're doing them correctly? For whatever hoops they want us to jump through, get the paperwork. Because otherwise, I can present all of this paperwork that I've amassed, but doesn't have anything to, is it going to be an appeal or is it just all paperwork? And you say they read it, they look at it, go to that.
No, but I think along with what these guys are saying, we all appeal, that all opens us up then to carry the appeal to the state level.
Correct.
And then I think the state level is where we'll maybe be able to inflect a little bit more change or opinion or a solution to the problem. And don't forget, we're still gonna meet Wednesday night with Bob Ross. And I don't know what magic wand Bob Ross is gonna have to say, oh yes, you know, you guys are right, you're wrongly. I don't know what he's gonna say. That's for us to flush out with him. You know, get there, just like we're asking questions, ask Bob Ross, ask who else is gonna be there, Sam Jones is gonna be there, and Jessica Huber is gonna be there as well. But those are the ones now to direct our...
If people just wanna send a message, okay, you have the power as citizens of Burton Township to circulate a petition, to put a referendum on the ballot at the next election, to abolish Burton Township.
And then what?
You only need 8%.
And go to a higher tax rate?
Well, then you have the county.
That's what they wanna do, but they don't say you wanna take the lower rate.
Then you have the county, and then you don't have this local fiscal.
I have to answer this part for you, because you need to understand. He's absolutely correct. I voted against combining townships. In Burton Township, if you combine with Richmond, and you have $100,000 assessment, your tax bill will go up $100 in Burton Township, your actual tax bill. And in fact, the way the state statute's set up, every time you combine townships, the higher rated township gets a tax break, the lower rated township gets a tax increase. Burton has a lower tax rate than Richmond, so your $100 would go to supplement Richmond. I'm pretty sure that nobody in this room that's in Burton Township wants to spend an extra $100 next year to lower Richmond's tax rate. And that's why I voted against it, and that's why Mr. Walkup is dead wrong. Unless the legislation changes, that's what will happen to you if you combine Richmond and Burton. Burton's tax rate goes up, it's a mathematical certainty. There is no, the way it sets right now, you have to blend the rates. You know, if you're the lower rate, you're going up. And that's why and we did the math, 133,000 people in McHenry County would have their taxes increase if we combined from 17 down to 8 townships.
I gotta say something here.
I think $100...
Hold on, please.
My tax...
We all agree that our tax assessor has discretion. She doesn't have to give you a 30% increase. I'm just so sick and tired of the damn politicians going around saying, oh, I'm gonna give you an increase. Joe is correct. The state statute says that yes, you do have to take the mix of the two and put it together. But you know what? Hold on, for 1 year, but hold on.
What's to say that you can't go to those two people who are running for assessor and say, are you going to raise the taxes or are you going to lower the taxes? You're going to lower them? Good, I'm going to vote for you. You're going to raise them? You're dead meat. Get the hell out. And by the way, your IRMF is gone, your pension's gone, your health care's gone. I am sick and freaking tired of us running around saying, oh, it's going to raise taxes. It's not. It's only going to raise the taxes if each and every single one of you allow it. And it doesn't happen. This is on you. This is on each and every one of you to get active. And that's why I came here and gave the speech I gave. Because we in Illinois, we know we're screwed.
Yeah, right.
You know, we keep on electing these politicians. How have these professional politicians done for you? I'm not a professional politician. I'm here for maybe 3 more years, and I'm freaking gone. I don't know what the hell I was thinking retiring to Illinois, but I did.
We're not here for this.
You have to fix it. You can fix it.
We can't it can't be. It's a game.
No, it's not a game.
Well,
it's a game of who you elect.
A game.
It's a game of who you elect and who's going to do the right thing for you.
But not when someone says, hey, I want you to target these three separate subdivisions.
This is not Burton Township. This is neighborhoods in Burton Township.
Yes.
Right. How do you fix that?
I'm telling you, number one, you appeal it. We all agree with that. But number two, you got to go after the person who targeted you. Your assessor's not elected.
No.
Supervisor assessor that directs your township assessor.
Appointed by
No, that's Ross. But what I'm saying
Hey guys, hold on a second.
I want to say something before I lose some folks here. Go ahead, and then I got one other thing I want to say. Folks, listen, Wednesday night we're going to meet with Bob Ross, Sam Jones, and I think Mark Eisenberg, our village president, is going to be there. That Wednesday night. Jessica's going to be there as well. Folks, the issue, you see how heated this is getting? This is for one reason. This is none of our faults. This, as I said in our website, this story has been written 30 years ago, and it's been written. Today is the day of reckoning. We're seeing that. There's nothing that these guys can do, because nothing that is going to make anybody happy. Because what everything that these guys can do, it's either tax, it's a combination of it. State of Illinois is broke. I think everybody understands that. There's almost $30 billion in bonds out there. That we're junk bond status. We're paying interest now as a taxpayer. So, you know, none of us want to have a credit card, right? Because credit card debt is, credit card interest is very high. It's an income that you don't have when you pay your credit card. Same thing with State of Illinois right now. State of Illinois is broke. They've tapped everything out. What the state is already doing is they are kicking financial obligations to the municipalities, the counties, the cities. Spring Grove lost their 13% of their budget last year over one of the distributed funds that they get from the state. Now, we're paying for that. Yours, the fireman, he's going to get whacked twice. If the solutions to this problem are addressed the way they're going to, the only way that they can get solved, it's not good for anybody. Everybody's going to be pissed. Yours is going to take a hit on taxes because taxes have to go up. At the same time, they're going to say, by the way, your benefits that were negotiated, we have to make adjustments to those. So somebody like Yoris or Rich Miltimore and Jenny, those folks take a double whammy. So I would be pissed if I was their householder. Now at the same time, you and I is just workers in the system that bring home a paycheck. We get whacked on the tax end and we're not happy about it. And so the situation that we're it's the state of Illinois. It's what it is. There's the only thing you can do about it. Because the taxes are going to rise. Things are not going to get pretty from here. It's not like today is a rainy day and tomorrow's going to be sunnier and sunnier. No, it's picture if you ran your credit card up at home and you ran your credit card sky high and now you made a decision, I need to get out of this mess. It affects your whole life because now instead of going out and going out for dinner or buying Christmas presents or doing the stuff that you would normally do, you're using those funds to pay off your debt. That is what the state of Illinois hasn't even begun. They're still trying to get whatever they can still
get.
They're 6 billion behind.
Yeah, they're still writing budgets that are so
That's why we're here, and that's the anger. Go ahead.
Just as data, you know, the other option is moving.
Moving.
I know what you're talking about. How many, I think this is mostly Sundial, how many of you guys are considering moving?
Yeah.
We gone.
You guys, did you see on the website I posted from our, I fly with guys from all over the country, and when we start talking about taxes and what we have, you know, because everybody always says, what do I give for my property? What's the show? And that's a whole other little rabbit hole to go down. But anyway, when I talk to people from around the country, and I tell them what I pay for my house, I'm like, they flip out. I posted it, because I don't think everybody realizes, you know, you can move anyone, and Wisconsin's not much better. So a lot of people think moving 4 miles north, it's not. They're just a little bit behind us.
Just so you know, Lori White has basically the same house, 3,100 square feet. She doesn't have 2.5 acres in Spring Grove. Now she has 7.5. And she was paying $9,000 here, and she's paying $3,700 there. So it just depends on where you move and how the assessor is.
Yeah.
Let's also put the other Wisconsin things out there. Your state income tax is higher. Mm-hmm. And if you're a retiree, you pay state income tax on your pension. They don't know.
But what I would say is this, when they do tax that and you are paying an income tax, you are also, it's more of a consumption tax, right? So if you hold on to what you have, when you go to the store, mm-hmm. you're paying that higher tax. If you don't spend it, you keep it. And that's the big thing.
That's sales tax, income tax. Income tax is 7.25, I believe, last time. And they charge you on your pensions and your social security.
That's another problem. You go to pensions, social security.
I'm not going to touch that.
No, you're not.
Yeah, no, you know, when you start making those, because like every state is different, they have different deductions, they have different things, so it's hard to...
I agree with that, but when I hear, we sat down and we have a budget, and this is what we need to operate. Well, I need it to operate too.
You're not being looked at all in your operating budget. We look at our budget, we say this is what we need, and one way or another, we're going to get the budget.
Yeah, that's exactly it.
And I'm not trying to be, I'm just telling you the truth. I'm not trying to secure...
But it's the truth.
So why are we paying part-time pensions?
Why are we paying part-time pensions?
Why do people in a part-time role get benefits?
And the thing with the part-time pensions in the county, there's a 1,000-hour deal or 600-hour deal. 1,000 hours is 20 weeks.
20 hours a week.
20 weeks a year. And I doubt how they all work.
Their meetings only last 45 minutes, and it's only once a month.
I can tell you, you can look at your county board members and say, oh, they're not that many. It depends on each individual worker. I can tell you, for our county board members, I think for our county board meetings, the committee groups, we're averaging about 2 hours and 10 minutes. That does not include the preparatory time that you go to. And I'm not making excuses, I'm just telling you the truth. Sometimes our packets are 200 pages that we're supposed to read, and sometimes it's 480. It just depends on each individual county board member and if they decide to actually sit down and do the work. And that's just the county board meeting. Then each county board member, Joe put aside each on at least three. And I'm thankful, because except for Mike, he got one. So for each committee meeting, that's anywhere from 150 to 200 pages. And that meeting can sometimes be, yes, sir. Elk Liquor Commission, 15-minute meeting. Not going to be, yes, sir. Law and Justice, Planning and Development, you are talking 3 and 4 hour meetings.
Do you get a stipend for those other?
No. Well, I don't know. No.
IMRF did a study of the whole thing, and they concluded that with prep time and meetings, the average county board member is putting in 750 hours a year without counting constituent services and things like this, and you know all the other things that are done. So that's their study.
I'm not arguing. I'm just saying it depends on each county board member and how well they want to represent and do the job that they want to do.
I think you need to trim the fat from inside your own operating system. I think you guys need to find a way to increase revenue, not through taxpayers, but through new business.
Absolutely.
And other avenues within the county. So, and I don't think you guys are doing a great job of that.
I'd like to tag on that, because the question I had is, I've been told by a pretty reputable source, and I've had research, the state of Illinois, and including our county, has 200 layers of additional
Bureaucracy.
Whatever, 200 layers. So to get that meeting on the 4th and to get to the right person, we're wasting our time with a lot of the little stuff because no one's going to answer to no one. We have to get to the right person and get some of these layers out, and that's the biggest problem.
Completely agree.
At 7,000 units of local government.
In Illinois.
The closest state to ours has 4,000, and most of them have 1,500, 2,000. So each one of those layers of government sets its own tax levy, okay? And then all we do as a county is collect the tax levy, add ours into it, and mail out the checks to all the other entities that have set these tax levies. So as long as you've got all these little, you know, fire protection districts and mosquito abatement districts and all these little units of government, you've got to do something to consolidate, I think, these units of government. And so you, because you aren't watching them, okay? How many of you voted in the 2013 spring elections? Okay,
yeah.
You've got to pay attention to local government. You've got to write herd on local government. You've got to get active. You can't wait for something to happen and then react to it. You have to be proactive and you have to get involved. Most people do not know who their county board representative is. Most people do not know what the county board does. Most people do not know who their state representative is. You go to Kmart right now, only 15% of the people are going to be able to tell you who their congressman is. Okay, it's, you know, you guys need to look in the mirror a little bit if you're concerned about government and say, what have I done in the last 2 years, 4 years, to acquaint myself with government at all levels and do something about it? So you can do some things about it. And what Joe was telling you about the tax thing was a red herring. Because what happens if you consolidate two townships is then you're electing a new township board right away. And they meet and they can set the rate with whatever they want.
It's true.
So whatever increase there is would be temporary and can be offset by the next board meeting that comes in. But again, you have to ride herd on the people. You have to find out which group of candidates are going to do that and which group of candidates are going to just keep sloughing at the public trough. You've got to make those decisions. You've got to be informed. And you can't just wait for something to happen and then try to be reactive. You have to be proactive, and we got elections coming up. Acquaint yourself about what's going on. Read the blogs, read the newspapers. Work on campaigns, circulate petitions, do stuff, get involved.
I totally agree, but nobody can anticipate 30% tax increase year over year. There's no way you can get ahead of that, is there?
Michael, go ahead. Rich is going to Rich.
That's been a great meeting. Thanks, everybody, for coming out. Could you just say again what the next meeting, when?
Wednesday. Wednesday at 7 o'clock at the village, Spring Grove Village Hall. Will be the next meeting.
Question.
Yeah,
we don't live in the
village. No, come on out because it has
the assessor's going to be there.
The assessor's going to be there.
Yeah. What I'm saying, we live in the village of Fox Lake.
Oh, so,
yes. Sales tax from Cleveland, like all the
district. You're 708 board. You have to tell them, look, we can't afford this anymore because I know what's happening. I'm not up for re-election. I'm working down in County Board District 1, so that's Algonquin, Cary, and Fox River. I've already knocked on over 1,500 doors, and I've talked to well over 1,000 people. And almost every single one of them says if they could leave Illinois, they would. And why is that? It's our property taxes. And everybody sits here working, well, we can go after the assessment, we can try to change the... We don't care about that. We want results, right? We want to say, how do we lower our property taxes? And the only way I know is to be able to control it locally. One of my favorite sayings is, control what you can control. If we're talking about elections, how can you change a president? We have one vote for president. But you know, that's 51 million votes to elect a president. But how many votes does it take to elect a new village trustee? About 350. Right? So that means a new mayor too. 350 votes. How about a new county board member? You know, that's about 4,000 votes, but if you want to try to change your congressman, that's about 430,000.
How much to change a school board member? About 330 here in Spring Grove. How much is it to change a state rep? Good luck beating Jack Franks. And I said that on tape, by the way, so everybody's going, oh my God. So my point is I want you to start learning about this process, but I want you to take an active control of the things that you can control and not worry about the things that you can't. And I am here simply to say there are people out there who are trying to actively lower your property taxes, and we definitely need to use the system, but we also basically need to say, look, the system stinks and we need to change it. And if you're not going to change it, if you're not going to fight for it, then please get out of the way and elect somebody who can. Because this isn't about sitting here having a popularity contest or taking a pension, which I'm not. We get good pensions. I'm not taking the health care, even though it's really good health care than what better than my life. And we need to make sure that we're term limiting ourselves. Get in there, fix what you can fix, and move on. And that's why I'm here. I'll be happy to answer any of your questions, and thank you very much. Appreciate it.
All right, so those are all very good political stump speeches, I think. Just my opinion. This is why we're here, right, folks? 29 points. That's what I just heard. How many heard any one of these guys talk about what we're here for? Raise your hand. I mean, Andrew did touch on it. I give him that. I don't know if I heard too much from Joe, and I think Michael went down the track a little bit too, but this is why we're here. 29.59% year-over-year increase. That's why we're here. That's what we want an answer to. There's no justice in that. I think I just asked the question that everybody is here to ask you guys.
You're right.
And not, I don't think anybody here answered that. We heard political stump speeches. No more political stump speeches, guys. The buck stops right here. So, Joe, do you want to comment again?
Sure. It's a quadrennial assessment, folks. That's what they do. They're asking you, and that's what I started. The way to change it is to appeal. If you don't appeal the taxes, it's going to stay right where it's at. In terms of Michael would like to change the whole thing, I don't want to go down that. I'll be glad to talk about township consolidation if you want to, but that's not what you're here for. I try to give you the from my perspective, what I not from my perspective. It's the only way you can change that.
So Joe, did the whole county go up?
The whole county went up. It depends on where you live and what your assessments. None of the townships hasn't published yet. I don't know what mine's done.
So Joe,
I'm sure it's going up.
My sister lives maybe half a mile from my neighborhood. You know what the taxes went up? 1.29%.
Well, so then she's probably looking at a different assessor.
Same Burton Township.
Okay. Then you have to look and see why your Burton Township assessor hit this group different than that group.
Okay, I can answer that question. Okay. When many of us called, I called as soon as I opened the thing and said, there's got to be an obvious error here for to year over year equalize the assessed value going up by 29.58%. There's a problem there. She said, no, there's no problem. I reassessed your area, and I was directed to do this because of the mistakes made by the previous assessor and mistakes made by the previous Board of Review members. And that was the explanation I was given. And she told me, go fight it at the, just as your time, go appeal it.
That's
but she said,
I'm
going
to do
it. Her exact words were, they're not going to do anything for you.
I don't know that they're not going to do anything for you.
And I understand that context. I understand.
I don't know what you were assessed before. I mean, I didn't look at your tax bill.
But this whole group was mistakes were made. This whole group.
I don't doubt it, but that's how you fix the mistakes is you do the appeal.
Chris,
if you don't do the appeal, they won't fix the mistake if you don't do the appeal.
My wife and I, we built our house in 2006 at the height of the real estate market. It was assessed, right?
Okay.
Now you're telling me now, like our taxes go up maybe $500, $800, we can deal with that, mm-hmm. right? Now I get a bill in the mail, and my potential net is going to be $4,000 higher, 31.67 increase. We've been assessed. We were not assessed properly in 2006. Come on.
Well, I don't know what you're assessed in 2006. Again, I'm not in a situation where I can say what was your bill, what was it before. All I can tell you is the question is supposed to ask is,
is that when they give you the new assessment, they're supposed to be saying, is this what a ready, willing, and able buyer would be willing to pay for this house if you were a ready, willing, and able seller?
And you want us to write the check and just not say anything? Oh, we're not going to notice it, right?
I want you to take an opinion.
You know, what we're here is to find out from you guys. You guys are up for reelection. What are you guys going to do to solve this issue? This is an issue.
You've got the wrong people in the office. You want to change that issue, you call the state reps.
Yeah, oh, Barbara Wheeler is probably watching right now at home. She is well aware. She is well aware.
But we're not, there's nothing that the county board can do that will change that physical, that process. That's a state legislative process. I mean, I'm here to try to tell you how to go about protecting your rights the best you can. But I don't have the ability, there's not a single piece of legislation I can put in at the county board that's going to change the property tax appeal process.
So it's completely, it's legit in Illinois to just, as Chris and everybody here, you know, just
I'm not saying it's legit, I'm saying appeal your taxes.
I think we've got two issues here.
Oh, go ahead.
One is what's happening right this minute.
Sure.
And the other is the bigger political arena. I don't think that this room of 60 people are going to affect the political arena right now today. What I'm here for is to understand the real process, not just the paperwork, not what website to go into. How do we find a comp? How do we find a comp that hasn't been short or foreclosed? My insurance, my real estate, includes those in my comp. The taxes don't. How do we understand that process?
And that's why you go on that and look at all of the sales in your area, and then you try to find sales that are like your house. I mean, and realtors can help you, appraisers can help you.
Excuse me. This is kind of like a dog and pony show so far. You know, what you're not telling these people is the tools. You're not giving them the tools how to appeal. I have several dozen rentals in Lake County, so I do this yearly.
Come on up and
well, you guys, all three of you guys, you're campaigning right now. You guys need to teach these people how to appeal. You briefly touched the PTAB, the state, and you said that's another chapter. No, that's not another chapter. Because what you guys are doing, and Jessica Huber, I'm really disappointed that she's not here, because all she does is kick the can
well,
down
she's a
to the board.
Right now, so.
And then Cliff Holton gets this complete us down in Mchenry every winter, you know, on our PTABs, or on our appeals. Educate these people. You say go to the MLS. Realtors are already taking a hit. They're not going to spend the time to pull comps. And MLS is great. What happens when you're fighting the assessment, not the comparable sales, the assessment?
Yes.
And you go to this website that you guys supposedly have now, which is terrible in my opinion. It doesn't tell you if it's a two-story, one-story. It doesn't tell you if it has brick, siding, finished basements, how many bathroom fixtures, and you need that information. Tell these people, you need that information, especially when you go to the state. Where am I going to get that from? I called Jessica Huber. You know what she says? I'll give you five or six. No, you're a public official. I want all of them. I want hundreds of them. You got to give me the property record card. She's tipping up to a line of state's attorney when she's only going to say, I'm going to give you five or six record property records.
She has to give you the records.
Well, then you know what? She's going to be busy because I need all of them. And I need those. But you guys, I don't even thank you for being here, but you aren't even in Burton Township. We need somebody with substance that's in Burton Township.
But
Jessica Huber and Bob, the chief assessor, where is he?
Yeah, but he should be something here. That board members can do here.
Yes.
And then you can have some influence on the supervising assessor in the county. We feel targeted. We're sitting here, got off in the rain. Come on here, because we feel targeted in certain areas in Burton Township. It's not all of Burton Township that got smoked. I saw one that their property tax went down $8,000. 70%. I read the spreadsheet.
Their assessment
went down.
Taxes.
Tax
dollars. I read the spreadsheet.
We extrapolated on the spreadsheet for the 2013 that we took last year's tax.
I'm concerned about the arbitrariness of the process. I'm concerned about how certain subdivisions can be targeted, and this time around, you guys are going to get smoked. Us are going to get smoked.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm not even anywhere near the worst of the bunch, but it's infuriating how this is so arbitrary. It's not township-wide. Oh, this subdivision is due for us just an absolute smoking. It's ridiculous, but you can do something. I do thank you, by the way, for coming here, because it's not easy to do, I'm sure. There's some things you'd rather do. But can you pressure the supervising assessor to stop this targeting BS in double-digit increases? That's ridiculous. Where is that done anywhere else?
How about you guys make the call to Jessica tonight or Monday?
And another thing, can you guys communicate with supervising assessor? You have administrative responsibilities.
Bob Ross is the next guy to talk to.
And let me make
I spoke to Bob Ross yesterday, basically because I knew I was coming here. He has said point blank, if you call him at his office, he will talk to him, he will arrange time to meet with you or talk to you.
But that cannot change the past.
It can't change what was just published. The only way you're going to change what was just published is to appeal that.
And folks, I got two things at the end here, two things already that I'll comment on. Wednesday, we're having another meeting with Bob Ross. Jessica Huber's going to be there, and I think Michael Eisenberg.
That's the one to attend.
That Wednesday.
Where?
It's going to be at the Village Hall. It's on
Spring Grove.
I've been up, yeah, Spring Grove. Yep, Village. The Village Hall in Spring Grove. You guys are all on email. I'll keep you guys. Obviously, I've been blasting you in the morning and blasting you in the evening with an email, and I'll keep doing that. And you guys will know that the meeting is Wednesday. On November 4th, and it's at 7 p.m., I believe. Don't quote me on that.
When's the deadline to appeal?
Deadline to appeal is November 15th. And I've got something to comment on that, too, so the comments that I'll make here when we're done.
Those that want to bring up comps, there's a really good website called Redfin, R-E-D-F-I-N. Log in, you create an account, it's free. And then you can get all of their homes that sold in the last couple of years that are comparable. You put your home in there, and it'll automatically search and find homes that sold in the last 2 years. You can build your comps in 10 minutes.
Go ahead.
We're kind of aliens here because we're from McHenry Township.
Yes.
It was our daughter lives in Spring Grove, and she kind of forwarded the information about this to us. And we've been hit really 32.27%.
Yeah, I'd be interested. I lobbied for the databases from the other townships. They're kind of reluctant to give them to me. But I have lobbied for your township because I want to do the same spreadsheet analysis that I did and see where this targeting is happening. But I did put in, and you have my email.
I have yours, but I couldn't put my email on your site this morning. I tried.
Okay, you have my email, though.
I don't. I only have your website.
Okay, on the website, my email is listed about three sentences down on the website. And I just visit afterwards, I can give it to you. What I would ask you to do is lobby your assessor to give you the database for Mchenry Township. And then you can forward me the database, and I will do exactly what I did with our database, manipulate your data. That's what I want to do. I'd love to have every township
get a call. Well, that's what I was thinking, if we joined together as a whole county.
Ask them nicely one time, and if they don't do it, FOIA it.
Yeah, I did a FOIA, I did a FOIA request.
Don't, honestly, I know it came off like I was kind of political, but you're in a political situation, and I know politics sucks. But quite honestly, if you don't go up and punch these people in the face, politically, not physically, and you don't start throwing FOIA bombs around, and you don't start pushing,
FOIA
is a freedom of information, because they're not. And it gets back to my whole point. They'll sit there and they'll just kick the can around and we'll just push the numbers around. And nothing's going to change. If you want to change it, yes, you have to go through the appeals and get your rates done. But if you do not do more than just that, then you're wasting your time. And I know people don't want to hear that, but I'm not going to tell you what you want to hear. I'm going to tell you the truth. So that's how you're going to have to do it.
It is a waste of time. The appeals process is archaic. We have a one story. I defy anybody to find another house like ours. I have every house that was sold in Burton Township from January 1st through July 31st, right here. Anybody want to look at it? You can. It's disgusting. There is no way that you can accurately appeal your taxes. It's an archaic system, and you can't find comparables. If you're going to make me have that, then please make it available.
You made a statement that the assessor was directed to come back to our subdivision.
No, not come back to the entire township. It's not necessarily your subdivision.
Who made that directive?
Every 4 years.
Who made the directive?
The directive's done by the state statute that says every 4 years you...
No, who told the assessor to do this?
Every 4 years, the assessor by state statute is required to do a quadrennial assessment.
That's not what you said. You said that she was told because there was mistakes and things.
He said that was Joe. I didn't have that.
She said that. Who said that to the assessor?
So if you look at past meeting notes on the board in both July and April of last year, Jessica brought that forward. Bob said to move ahead with it, even though there was double-digit increases.
Bob who?
Bob Ross.
Bob Ross, chief assessor for McHenry County.
The one who's not here.
He's the one that we're going to be speaking with on Wednesday.
See, the whole thing is where it starts, not where it ended. We need to know who is the person that directed her to come back.
Those are all in the historical meeting notes on the website.
It's a township website.
Yep, township website.
Fairtownship.com.
I have one other question. Who's paying for the lawsuit about you guys' pensions? And you are. The county?
I'm not aware of a lawsuit.
Yeah.
Yes, there's a lawsuit, a class action lawsuit brought against the county board for their MIRF.
IMRF.
Because they're supposed to...
I haven't served it. I haven't served all of them. I haven't served it. That's...
So where you're supposed to, you can either go 1,000 hours or 600 hours?
I know the local 150 is doing things that they like to talk about then. If they're filing a suit, they haven't served us yet. I don't have any sense to it.
So I just want to, I mean, I know people don't want to hear the long term, but this is really, the whole reason I had a problem here is because of the bifurcated system that you have for assessments. The county, you're talking to the wrong people about assessments, because the way the system is set up, it's done by the townships. And if you want to make the township assessors accountable, you have to do it at the elections. The problem is that nobody shows up for the township elections because they don't know when they are.
But the county supervising assessor, Mr. Ross,
right,
directed our township assessor to do these things. So she's beholden to him. And I believe he's beholden to you.
No. No, he's beholden to Illinois state statute for such.
You have no administrative authority, no policy-making authority over him?
Policy-making, none whatsoever.
Isn't he appointed?
He is appointed by us, and so in theory...
Get rid of him.
He's appointed by you.
Whoever's in that role is going to be stuck with the same statute.
So why did he start with our neighborhood specifically?
I don't have any idea why he's there.
We'll find out Tuesday.
I just wanted to tell you, the township election will be in 2017 in the spring, when you have your municipal election. So, and you need to, if you don't like the assessor, you've got to find somebody who's got the credentials to be the assessor to run against them, because typically nobody runs. And you have to have certain credentials in order to run, and you have to go out and circulate a petition. So that's how you make the township assessor accountable, is you hold his feet to the fire every 4 years, and they have the elections, which are an odd number of years, every 4 years. So the next opportunity is going to be 2017. After that, you won't have another opportunity for 4 more years. So you have to be on your toes. We have to start organizing, and the way you hold people accountable is through the election process. If people don't show up for the election, if people are in the dark about when the elections are, if they're confused because the election for the township is a different cycle than all the other elections, which take place every 2 years, the townships every 4 years, and people forget, oh, is this year we have the township or not? That's the problem.
I thought I just understood, though, that it doesn't matter because the assessor is beholden to the statutes.
Well, so but you can change the assessor.
We were just told
he has
that the assessor does according to the state statute.
Yeah, but he has discretion on how he sets the assessments. He has to assess them every 4 years, but he doesn't have to. How he does it, it's a judgment call. Okay. So if you don't like the judgment calls that the assessor is making, place the assessor.
Well, I called Jessica months ago, and she was the one that told me that three neighborhoods in Spring Grove was her target. So. Because ours went up, we bought our house, and '09, and ours went up, actually did the math, 50% after we bought. So I've tried to fight every year and I've gotten nowhere. Called your schools, Eugene, and so that's us, so. Did anyone else go up like other years prior to? When we bought it was eight, we got our bill, 12. But our assessed value is 200,000 less than, I mean, so what do I even do? I would go up, our house is not, is definitely worth more than what it says, but our taxes are 12.5.
I think this is the first year for us here where we had high double digit, 15, 20, I think all of us can say in the last 5, 6 years, it's fluctuated plus or minus 4, plus or minus 5%. Our argument here today is, all of us here went up. By, you know, I mean, mine's 29.58. Come on, let's hear some numbers.
31.
That's
much
wrong.
There's something wrong with this.
Ross.
So did we get comparable? What did we start doing before? Before? We have 15 days, so we got to be able to get comparable.
The other part of your deal process is to look at, you know, why is your neighborhood singled out, and that's correct. You know, why is your, I don't know how, you know, I don't know much about your particular neighborhood other than what it seems to me is that everybody's gone up 30%. So why is, and I agree with you, why is your neighborhood different from the one across the street?
It was very, I assumed everybody was high when ours went up, and then I, in the last year, was looking into it more, and it was all over the board. I thought we should have gone down to match everybody. Yeah. Houses that were similar to ours were eight, and it just, there was no rhyme or reason, which she did say, she was, but I assumed she was going to bring.
Yeah, you bring
the high ones
down,
not
everybody up. So you're saying do the appeal process, but you're saying you've done it and it was unsuccessful. So is the appeal process, are we all going to go through the appeal process and it's going to be a waste of time?
Yeah.
All right, so that leads me to what I was going to say. All right, so at the end of the day, the comparable thing. It's a BS game, in my opinion, but it's a game you play. We can't win. You go in there against four other guys behind a computer. You're a little Joe Blow homeowner, and they look at you like, oh, well, too bad. Have a nice day. They may sprinkle a little deduction on you, just make them think you feel you got something. But it, to us, is just common homeowners. It's a game. So my opinion would be we are going to compare as a group. Instead of comparing and pitting each other to do all this monkey work of this house, that house, this house. No, we're a group. We'll compare our group to, let's compare to a subdivision over here that only went up 2% or went down minus 2%.
Yeah, absolutely.
The comparison is, why did we go up 30%? You know, we could do the average here and say, why did we go up in that 25%? Why is this? Town or
exactly.
Yeah, instead of playing this game where we're going to pit each other, Joe Kime against Joey St. Pierre against the Malik's. No, we're not going to play that game. We'll get a lawyer if we have to. We'll take it as a group comparable. Let's do a group comparison. Because I think, in my opinion, that's what we're arguing. None of us had any issues. The plus or minus 5-6% year to year. I get that. I understand that. It's when you see something that's 20-25%, even above 10 is ridiculous. That's what we're arguing.
I highly encourage every single one of you to appeal with the board in Mchenry. You have to do that. If you don't do that, you cannot go to the state. Once you appeal, whether
exactly.
You win or lose, doesn't matter. They'll give you the piece of paper with the change or no change. You have 30 days to appeal with the state. The state will take up to 2 years. Generally, the county will intervene and negotiate with you. I've always gotten a negotiation with the state. When the state's involved, not with the state, I take that back. When the state's involved, the chief assessor will call me and say, will you accept this? It's worth it, guys. It's more paperwork, but you gotta do it. You have to appeal with the county, though. You got 15 days, do it. This election, we don't have time for another election. We gotta pay taxes now.
Yeah.
We don't have time for 2017 and all that BS. You gotta appeal. And you got to get on that phone with Jessica Huber and get your proper information, because you're going to see on the appeal form, it's going to ask you, finished basement, how many bathroom fixtures, things of that nature, brick, siding, you need at least three comparables. Give them 6 to 9.
How do you get them up?
Redfin, that's...
That's fine, but Redfin is an avenue, but if you're going to do assess value on the tax assessment, Redfin won't hurt, won't help you.
No.
So you still, and Redfin, if you didn't sell your house, you won't be on Redfin.
And you won't have...
If I'm going to fight on the assessed value, you have two options, assessed value or comparable sales.
Yeah.
I encourage you to do it. That's my argument with these guys, we need the proper tools to appeal. And it's not, Lake County has a great site. Everything's out there, turns out the grid for you. It's an awesome site, tells you everything. You type in a PIN number, you can look it up. Is it the same house code? It tells you.
And you know, I'll put a link, the Burton Township, I didn't see this originally, but they do have now a GIS link that takes you to a map. And it is, it's not the most user-friendly interface. But you can, you know, it's not like Zillow, where Zillow pretty much leads you, you know, whatever you want. It's a not a user-friendly interface, but you can get, you know, you can put in a search for last year, all sales between this dollar amount, this dollar. There's a bunch of different variables that you can put in. It takes a minute, it searches, because it's searching a government database. Searches, then it comes back, and but it does work, and it does give you the information that... And you can even search PIN numbers and everything through that.
Got an appeal, don't lay down...
Does it have to be a current year appeal on a sold house?
Not necessarily.
Yes.
No, you can, I think they're kind of, you know, if you bring in, here's my advice.
Okay.
Play the game however you want, whatever you want to do. I don't know what advice, because I don't know how to, it's trying to beat the system.
I don't know how to appeal if there aren't houses that I can...
It depends on who's on the table at the board.
Yeah.
You'll get one, two people say within a mile.
You can go back, you do the best that you have. I mean, if there's no comparables that you can find, then there's no comparables the other side finds. They keep expanding that circle to find one. And they go before January 1st if they don't have any after January 1st. They will look both directions. I mean, just as any appraiser would do, you've got to look to find what's the closest thing on the market that you can compare it to.
Exactly, but does it have to be in Burton Township?
Yes.
It cannot be in Burton Township, okay. That's what we have to grant it.
We're currently on the market, we have an active appraisal. They couldn't find any in Burton Township. We're compared to starting up toward Wisconsin, out toward Antioch and Libertyville. They couldn't find. We're held to a standard to play this game that the realtors can't. It's a game, and it's just... How do you play the game? I've heard that term about 6 times. That's madness.
You bring in the best comparables you can find.
But if there aren't any...
If there aren't any, you keep going further back in time.
You've got to go back.
Forward in time. You keep looking for something.
The other question is, does it include short and foreclosed? I was told that for this purpose...
They will argue with you that it does not include short sales. I would still, if that's all I had, I'd still bring them in.
That's our real estate is all.
The state says you have to arm length transaction. The state. The assessor will tell you that, hey, we don't really accept distressed property. But what she or he won't tell you is the board will consider it, if that's all you have. And definitely the state will.
The real estate company considers it when they set our value.
The bank is selling it at an arm's length agreement to run as well.
And it's personally, especially in 09,
010,
and 10,
everything was short. Right, it's a good thing that we get a tax, a flat tax, I haven't raised it in 2 or 3 years. That's great, but also tell these people that, hey, we got a lot of foreclosures, that people weren't living in those houses, and the banks are still paying the full tax. No one's using the stills, no amenities, that's free money.
I brought that up.
Well, where's that going?
We brought that up.
One problem about that issue with schools, Crystal Lakes, where I live, they're down 2 entire grade levels in terms of population. They've closed up.
But the houses are still getting paid, unless I go down there and I buy tax money, but still, the banks are paying the taxes, 10 grand, and there's no amenities being used by that household. That's free money.
Yep. All right, one of the problems, and I filed, you know, an appeal, but the property used, I don't know what the tax quadriannual is, because it is not available. You know what I'm saying?
No,
so if I look at a comp, all right, I'm basing it on my existing, you know, tax base. But now if I go from, let's say,
my taxes are going to go up from 10 to 15,000. Because of the quadrennial.
Well,
if you... And if you look at your comps, you can't look at that.
If you, you're jumping to the back end with the tax bills. When you're doing appeal, you're just appealing, what's the value of my house? You're not appealing the value of your tax bill.
Your cash value.
Okay, you're looking at your fair cash market value of your house. So you're not worried about, I know you're personally very worried about your tax bill, but you're worried about what the part that they're going to multiply that rate by. And that's the part that you can appeal. So you're just looking at the value of houses right now.
Question. So this Bob Ross, he's appointed by you guys?
He's appointed by us. But he doesn't. He's got some statute things that he can go in and actually, if this whole neighborhood's off and you can see that it's off, he has some adjustment abilities that he can do at that level. But he can't, he doesn't actually assess your individual tax rates. That's what comes to the township.
So Joe, could Bob Ross have, like, instead of 30, 31, 36%, could he have done 50, 100%?
Yeah.
Yeah, there were people in that spreadsheet. There are folks that are assessed over 100%.
And if so, who oversees Bob Ross?
That's what the board does. But there's got to be some...
Are you guys
on
the board
right now? No.
We appoint the board.
Some states do. Some states do. Illinois does not. Some states have a max cap that they can raise your assessment year over year. Illinois does have something buried in the statutes, but I don't know the legal jargon, that the max that they can raise you is 5% unless they follow certain steps. Now, I did not investigate.
That's the property tax levy. That's not the same thing.
Okay, so that's not the same thing. Okay.
You appoint Bob Ross, and then you appoint the people that oversee Bob Ross. So what,
we don't
sit
here. Well, the reason it doesn't is that we're not allowed to go in. I'm not allowed to go in as a county board member and say, you know, I'm firing the board of review. I mean, all that's going to do is have the state come in and take it over. I mean, the board of review is generally consistent.
So we could make
it
more quickly if we didn't.
Well, I probably have a defect in your appeal. I mean, they'd probably not let you.
Oh, for what we're talking about, Barbara Wheeler is our representative, the 64th district. She is the one that would represent us to eventually get a cap on what they can raise our year-over-year property assessments by.
Well, I know she can't be here, but for whatever reason, but is she, in your conversation, is she friendly to us?
Yeah, she's on our side. I spoke with Barbara yesterday. She is, like I said in the email this morning, she's investigating this on her end, because she doesn't agree with this. She doesn't agree that, you know, you can just go in and lobby a 25% year-over-year increase in an assessment. She is in agreement with that. But I think, as we're seeing here this morning, what do you do about that?
Right.
What's the answer? Who's the man in charge? Who do we talk to? Who do we tar and feather? That's who we're looking for this morning, and nobody wants to, Bob Ross, I guess, is about, on Wednesday night, the one that we should start pointing fingers at. Now, these guys are here because we're voicing our concern, our elected officials. They need to know what we're talking
about.
Can
we get the board of review that reviews Bob? Can they be there for this meeting?
How do they determine the board of review?
The board of review is a group of people that apply for the job. Mm-hmm. They have state requirements that they have appraisal certificates, and they have, they're basically appraisers.
Mm-hmm.
Is what they are.
And they have standard terms, so we can't just get rid of all of them.
Cliff Holton is still on the board?
I don't know.
I don't remember. He lives in Forest Ridge. I'm sure he can make a call.
Yeah, he could be there one day. Another thing I want to bring up, our assessors, do you guys know by law, do they need to live in a county, township, county, or
county? If elected, yes.
If appointed, no. Okay.
You're correct.
So, but you can't stand for re-election.
Mm-hmm.
So, Joe, one more question. Does it behoove us to think about litigation in any of this?
Well, your litigation is exactly what the gentleman said. You start with board review. That's the beginning of your litigation. You can then take it to the Property Tax Appeal Board in Springfield. and, you know, the appeal process. That's the process that you take.
So we can't hire an attorney?
You can hire an attorney.
We will. That is.
Do you want that?
Yeah, we will. We'll hire that as a group.
There's two or three in Mchenry County that do a lot of this.
Is it as a subdivision, say, or as a group?
That would be your deal. You negotiate with whoever you decide to hire. But you know, there are, without a great deal of effort, I'm sure you can find some that do this.
But a group could stand up before a supervising assessor or other people in the process as a group?
There's no reason why you couldn't assume that.
Yeah, there's no reason why we couldn't.
Someone wants to do it. It still sounds like it still has to start with this. You have to start with an appeal.
We all have to do it individually.
Yeah, it's individual.
Every one of us should.
Yeah, we'll all file an individual appeal. But then as a group, we'll find a lawyer or even a representative. Even if it happens to be myself, but it's probably more appropriate a lawyer. And have a lawyer, see if we can get a lawyer that says, I'm going to go fight you guys as a group appeal. And I mean, it may be totally unconventional, but we got nothing to lose.
It'll keep you in the forefront.
Yeah.
I mean, I think you have to pay lawyers.
That's the road I was going down. Once you bring the lawyers in, now we're just feeding the system more.
You guys can do this yourself, I'm telling you. You know, lawyers can take 40%.
Yeah.
You can do it yourself.
That's where I'm going with.
Know your community, do it yourself. It'll take you the first time, maybe an hour, to fill out the appeal.
No, I think, how many of us in here have fought our appeals before?
Well, by the time we get all the appeals.
Yeah, a bunch of us have.
Why don't we get together and do our appeals together so that we know that we're doing them correctly? For whatever hoops they want us to jump through, get the paperwork. Because otherwise, I can present all of this paperwork that I've amassed, but does it have anything to, is it going to be an appeal or is it just all paperwork? And you said they read it, they look at it, and go to that.
No, but I think along with what these guys are saying, we all appeal. That all opens us up then to carry the appeal to the state level.
Correct.
And then I think the state level is where we'll maybe be able to inflect a little bit more change or opinion or a solution to the problem. And don't forget, we're still going to meet Wednesday night with right. Bob Ross. And I don't know what magic wand Bob Ross is going to have to say, oh yes, you know, you guys are right, you're wrongly. I don't know what he's going to say. That's for us to flush out with him. You know, get there, just like we're asking questions, ask Bob Ross, ask who else is going to be there. Sam Jones is going to be there. And Jessica Hubert is going to be there as well. But those are the ones now to direct our.
If people just want to send a message, okay, you have the power as citizens of Burton Township to circulate a petition to put a referendum on the ballot at the next election to abolish Burton Township.
And then what?
You only need 8%.
And go to a higher tax rate?
Well, then you have the county.
That's what they want to do, but they don't say you want to take the lower rate.
Then you have the county, and then you don't have this local fiscal.
I have to answer this part for you, because you need to understand. He's absolutely correct. I voted against combining townships. In Burton Township, if you combine with Richmond and you have a $100,000 assessment, your tax bill will go up $100 in Burton Township, your actual tax bill. And in fact, the way the state statute is set up, every time you combine townships, the higher rated township gets a tax break, the lower rated township gets a tax increase. Burton has a lower tax rate than Richmond, so your $100 would go to supplement Richmond. I'm pretty sure that nobody in this room that's in Burton Township wants to spend an extra $100 next year to lower Richmond's tax rate. And that's why I voted against it. And that's why Mr. Walkup is dead wrong. Unless the legislation changes, that's what will happen to you if you combine Richmond and Burton. Burton's tax rate goes up. It's a mathematical certainty. There is no, the way it sets right now, you have to blend the rates. You know, if you're the lower rate, you're going up. And that's why and we did the math, 133,000 people in McHenry County would have their taxes increase if we combined from 17 down to 8 townships.
I got to say something here.
I think $100.
Hold on, please.
My tax.
We all agree that our tax assessor has discretion. She doesn't have to give you a 30% increase. I'm just so sick and tired of the damn politicians going around saying, oh, I'm going to give you an increase.
Joe is correct. The state statute says that, yes, you do have to take the mix of the two and put it together. But you know what? Hold on, for 1 year. But hold on, hold on. What's to say that you can't go to those two people who are running for assessor and say, are you going to raise the taxes or are you going to lower the taxes? You're going to lower them? Good, I'm going to vote for you. You're going to raise them? You're dead meat. Get the hell out. And by the way, your IRMF is gone. Your pension's gone. Your health care's gone. I am sick and freaking tired of us running around saying, oh, it's going to raise taxes. It's not. It's only going to raise the taxes if each and every single one of you allow it. And it doesn't happen. This is on you. This is on each and every one of you to get active. And that's why I came here and gave the speech I gave. Because we in Illinois, we know we're screwed.
Yeah, right.
You know, we keep on electing these politicians. How have these professional politicians done for you? I'm not a professional politician. I'm here for maybe 3 more years, and I'm freaking gone. I don't know what the hell I was thinking retiring to Illinois, but I did.
We're not here for this.
No, you have to fix it. You can fix it.
It can't be a game.
No, it's not a game.
It's a game of who you elect.
It's a game of who you elect and who's going to do the right thing for you.
But not when someone says, hey, I want you to target these three separate subdivisions.
This is not Burton Township. This is neighborhoods in Burton Township.
Yes.
How do you fix that?
I'm telling you, number one, you appeal it. We all agree with that. But number two, you got to go after the person who targeted you. But then you need to find somebody that will run for it. Your assessor's not elected.
No, that's Ross, but what I'm saying is, hey guys, hold on a second. I want to say something before I lose some folks here.
Go ahead, and then I got one other thing I want to say.
Folks, listen, Wednesday night we're going to meet with Bob Ross, Sam Jones, and I think Mark Eisenberg, our village president, is going to be there. That Wednesday night. Jessica's going to be there as well. Folks, the issue, do you see how heated this is getting? This is for one reason. This is none of our faults. This, as I said in our website, this story has been written 30 years ago, and it's been written. Today is the day of reckoning. We're seeing that. There's nothing that these guys can do. Because nothing that is going to make anybody happy. Because everything that these guys can do, it's either tax, it's a combination of things. State of Illinois is broke. I think everybody understands that. There's almost $30 billion in bonds out there. That we're junk bond status. We're paying interest now as a taxpayer. So, you know, none of us want to have a credit card, right? Because credit card interest is very high. It's an income that you don't have when you pay your credit card. Same thing with State of Illinois right now. State of Illinois is broke. They've tapped everything out. What the state is already doing is they are kicking financial obligations to the municipalities, the counties, the cities. Spring Grove lost their 13% of their budget last year over one of the distributed funds that they get from the state. Now, we're paying for that. Yoris, the fireman, he's going to get whacked twice. If the solutions to this problem are addressed the way they're going to, the only way that they can get solved, it's not good for anybody. Everybody's going to be pissed. Yoris is going to take a hit on taxes because taxes have to go up. At the same time, they're going to say, by the way, your benefits that were negotiated, we have to make adjustments to those. So somebody like Yoris or Rich Miltimore and Jenny, those folks take a double whammy. So I would be pissed if I was their householder. Now at the same time, you and I is just workers in the system that bring home a paycheck. We get whacked on the tax end and we're not happy about it. And so the situation that we're in, it's the state of Illinois. It's what it is. There's the only thing you can do about it. Because the taxes are going to rise. Things are not going to get pretty from here. It's not like today is a rainy day and tomorrow's going to be sunnier and sunnier. No. It's picture if you ran your credit card up at home and you ran your credit card sky high. And now you made a decision, I need to get out of this mess. It affects your whole life because now instead of going out and going out for dinner or buying Christmas presents or doing the stuff that you would normally do, you're using those funds to pay off your debt. That is what the state of Illinois hasn't even begun. They're still trying to get whatever they can still get.
They're $6 billion behind.
Yeah, they're still writing budgets that are
That, so that's why we're here, and that's the anger. Go ahead.
Just as data, you know, the other option is moving.
Moving.
I know we're talking.
Moving, yeah.
How many, sorry, I think this is mostly Sundial. How many of you guys are considering moving?
Yeah.
We go.
You guys, did you see on the website I posted from our, I fly with guys from all over the country. And when we start talking about Texas and what we have, you know, because everybody always says, what do I give for my property? What's the show? And that's a whole other little rabbit hole to go down. But anyway, when I talk to people from around the country and I tell them what I pay for my house, I'm like, they flip out. I posted it because I don't think everybody realizes, you know, you can move. Anyone in Wisconsin's not much better. So a lot of people think moving 4 miles north, it's not. It's not. They're just a little bit behind us.
Yeah. Just so you know, Lori White has basically the same house, 3,100 square feet. She doesn't have 2.5 acres in Spring Grove. Now she has 7.5. And she was paying 9,000 here, and she's paying 3,700 there. So it just depends on where you move and how the assessor is.
Yeah.
Let's also put the other Wisconsin things out there. Your state income tax is higher. Mm-hmm. And if you're a retiree, you pay state income tax on your pension. They don't know.
But what I would say is this. When they do tax that and you are paying an income tax, you are also, it's more of a consumption tax, right? So if you hold on to what you have when you go to the store, mm-hmm. you're paying that higher tax. If you don't spend it, you keep it. And that's the big thing.
That's sales tax, income tax. Income tax is 7.25, I believe, Wisconsin. And they charge you on your pensions and your social security.
That's another problem. You go to pensions, social security.
Oh, I'm not going to touch that.
No, you're not.
Yeah, no, you know, when you start making those, because like every state is different, they have different deductions, they have different things, so it's hard to...
I agree with that, but when I hear, we sat down and we have a budget, and this is what we need to operate. Well, I need it to operate too.
You're not being looked at all in your operating budget. We look at our budget and we say, this is what we need, and one way or another, we're going to get the budget.
Yeah, that's exactly it.
And I'm not trying to be, I'm just telling you the truth. I'm not trying to secure...
But it's the truth.
So why are we paying part-time pensions?
Why are we paying part-time
pensions? Why do people in a part-time role get benefits?
Yeah. And the thing with the part-time pensions in the economy, there's a 1,000-hour deal or 600-hour deal. Mm-hmm. 1,000 hours is 20 weeks.
20 hours a week.
20 weeks a year. And I doubt they all work. You know,
their meetings only last 45 minutes, and it's only
that's,
once a month.
That's not
actually, I'm worried about studying that.
I can tell you, you can look at your county board members and say, oh, they're not that many. It depends on each individual worker. I can tell you, for our county board members, I think we're average, for our county board meetings, the committee groups, we're averaging about 2 hours and 10 minutes. That does not include the preparatory time that you go to. And I'm not making excuses, I'm just telling you the truth. Sometimes our packets are 200 pages that we're supposed to read, and sometimes it's 480. It just depends on each individual county board member and if they decide to actually sit down and do the work. And that's just the county board meeting. Then each county board member, we are, Joe put aside each on at least three. And I'm thankful, because except for Mike, he got it. So for each committee meeting, that's anywhere from 150 to 200 pages. And that meeting can sometimes be, yes, sir. Elk Liquor Commission, 15-minute meeting. Not going to be, yes, sir. Law and Justice, Planning and Development, you are talking 3 and 4 hour meetings.
Do you get a stipend for those other?
No. Well, I don't know. No.
I am aware that did a study of the whole thing, and they concluded that with prep time and meetings, the average county board member is putting in 750 hours a year without counting constituent services and things like this, and you know all the other things that are done. So that's their study. So,
I'm not arguing. I'm just saying it depends on each county board member and how well they want to represent and do the job that they want to do.
I think you need to trim the fat from inside your own operating system. I think you guys need to find a way to increase revenue, not through taxpayers, but through new business.
Absolutely.
And other avenues within the county. So, and I don't think you guys are doing a great job of that.
I'd like to tag on that, because the question I had is, I've been told by a pretty reputable source, and I've had research, the state of Illinois, and including our county, has 200 layers of additional...
bureaucracy.
Whatever, 200 layers. So to get that meeting on the 4th and to get to the right person, we're wasting our time with a lot of the little stuff because no one's going to answer to no one. We have to get to the right person and get some of these layers out, and that's the biggest problem.
Completely agree.
There's 7,000 units of local government.
In Illinois.
The closest state to ours has 4,000, and most of them have 1,500, 2,000. So each one of those layers of government sets its own tax levy, okay? And then all we do as a county is collect the tax levy, add ours into it, and mail out the checks to all the other entities that have set these tax levies. So as long as you've got all these little, you know, fire protection districts and mosquito abatement districts and all these little units of government, you've got to do something to consolidate, I think, these units of government. And so you, because you aren't watching them, okay? How many of you voted in the 2013 spring elections? Okay,
yeah.
You've got to pay attention to local government. You've got to write herd on local government. You've got to get active. You can't wait for something to happen and then react to it. You have to be proactive and you have to get involved. Most people do not know who their county board representative is. Most people do not know what the county board does. Most people do not know who their state representative is. You go to Kmart right now, only 15% of the people are going to be able to tell you who their congressman is. Okay, it's, you know, you guys need to look in the mirror a little bit if you're concerned about government and say, what have I done in the last 2 years, 4 years, to acquaint myself with government at all levels and do something about it? So you can do some things about it. And what Joe was telling you about the tax thing was a red herring. Because what happens if you consolidate two townships is then you're electing a new township board right away. And they meet and they can set the rate with whatever they want.
It's true.
So whatever increase there is would be temporary and can be offset by the next board meeting that comes in. But again, you have to ride herd on the people. You have to find out which group of candidates are going to do that and which group of candidates are going to just keep sloughing at the public trump. You've got to make those decisions. You've got to be informed. And you can't just wait for something to happen and then try to be reactive.
You have to be
proactive. And we got elections coming up. Acquaint yourself about what's going on. Read the blogs. Read the newspapers. Work on campaigns, circulate petitions, do stuff, get involved.
I totally agree, but nobody could anticipate 30% tax increase year over year. There's no way you had to get ahead of that, is there?
Well, go ahead. Rich is going to
Rich. That's been a great meeting. Thanks, everybody, for coming out. Could you just say again what the next meeting, when?
Wednesday. Wednesday at 7 o'clock at the village, Spring Grove Village Hall. It will be the next meeting.
Question.
Yeah, we don't
live in
the
village.
No, come on out, because it has
a
session.
Yeah. What I'm saying, we live in the village of Fox Lake.
Oh,
sales tax
from
Cleveland,
like
all the
yes.
No, it's a problem. You've got some more political officials that can do something else.